Now something about the pushover load pattern, that what pattern we should select to push our building, which pattern is more representative of the future ground shaking, because the future ground shaking we know is random. So actually the effective earthquake forces, they are random along the story height. So we cannot apply a random force pattern to push our building to represent future ground shaking. So we have to select a simple lateral load pattern, which is simple but at the same time should somehow represent our loading which is expected in future ground shaking. So actually very first thing is that we start with gravity loads, which means that when we start pushing the building, the gravity load should already be there. There should already be gravity load on your building. So you have to make a non-linear gravity load first, gravity case first, and apply that and use that load case as a predecessor to the pushover load case. So when you start pushing, you will be start pushing at the end of the application of gravity load. Gravity load should already be there when you start pushing. Secondly, which type of load pattern you should use to push your building? There are several patterns available in literature. Previously, the uniform or rectangular pattern was used, and you can also use a code specified static lateral load pattern, somehow similar to inverted triangle. Inverted triangle means that the maximum force is on top and you keep on reducing it until it becomes zero at the bottom. But the most commonly used method, the pattern is this one. First mode shape pattern, assuming that the building will primarily deform in first mode shape only, you apply a load pattern which matches with the first mode shape. You apply a pattern which is proportional to first mode shape so that it deform the building in the first mode shape manner, right? Because we know that the maximum contribution of displacement is coming from the first mode in overall building's response. So we select a load pattern which is proportional to first mode shape. So if the first mode shape is like this for this building, we apply forces which are actually varying in that same pattern. So we actually calculate first that pattern which is proportional to first mode shape and then apply it from a very low value and keep on increasing its amplitude until the building is significantly yielded. So this is an example of how we calculate the first mode shape pattern, that phi is the first mode shape and wi is the story weight. So this is also sometimes called as the modal inertia load pattern, that it is the product of story weight times the mode shape value at that level. This FPI or this pattern will deform the building in exactly the first mode shape manner, right? So this is a more representative of the effective earthquake forces in, which can be caused by future ground shaking. Now you might have guessed by now that if the building is low rise, this pattern can represent the effective earthquake forces adequately. But if the building is high rise, it may have contribution not only from first mode but from other modes also, second and third mode also. So by pushing the building alone in the first mode may not be enough. So therefore we have multi-mode pushover analysis methods, which says that you push the building not only once but more than once, and each time you use a different mode shape pattern to push the building, and then you perform the pushover analysis or determine the seismic responses from each of the pushover analysis for each mode separately, and then combine the results statistically like SRSS or CQC, just like in the response spectrum analysis method. So the multi-mode pushover analysis differ from the first mode shape pushover methods here, where they say that we should push the building not only in the first mode shape pattern, but more than first mode shape pattern also, like second mode shape pattern, third mode shape pattern. So second mode shape pattern may look like this, that first few stories will have a force towards right hand side, but bottom few may have a force towards left hand side. This will be a pattern which will deform your building in the second mode shape. Similarly, you may have a third mode shape pattern also. First few stories towards right hand side, in the middle you may have left hand side, and in the bottom you again have right hand side. So you may have more than one mode shape patterns, but for conventional low to mid-rise buildings, only the first mode shape pattern is mostly used. So nowadays we don't use uniform or any other load pattern. This first mode shape load pattern is the most commonly used pattern for pushover analysis nowadays. So this is also sometimes called as the first mode inertia load pattern. Inertia means that you have this product of mass and that mode shape. So at any ith story, the force will be calculated as the mass of that story times the ordinate of that first mode shape vector. So this product will give you a force pattern, and the sum of all those story forces or that whole pattern will be the base shear, right? But again, I will say that this is acceptable only for those structures which have time period less than or equal to one. Low rise or mid rise buildings. If the building is high rise, the second mode may also have a significant contribution. And then you may have multi-mode pushover analysis method, which means that you may have second mode inertia pattern, third mode inertia load pattern, and you can keep on adding more number of modes. So for more flexible structures, high rise buildings, the contribution of higher vibration modes may become significant and need to be considered in the pushover analysis. Actually, this is the domain of multi-mode pushover analysis or the modal pushover analysis, as I have said in the start.